This is it. This is where I'm supposed to be. And as a black man,
why we as Americans have to reconnect with our roots.
The depth of suffering and the height of joy that these songs can articulate.
One way that we can explain the mother of God is in song. My mother.
So how did we get where we are today? A discernible shift in the place of
Africa. What is most important in our lives?
Light in my darkness. The Holy Spirit is able to.
He said, if you're going to participate in the movement, you've got to prepare yourself.
Our next speaker is Father Terrell Qualls. He serves on the board of directors for the Fellowship of St. Moses the Black. He has lectured in various parts of the United States in regard to the work of evangelization and cultural outreach within the United States. As a former youth minister within the Evangelical Church, Father Terrell has dedicated much of his life and work to the pragmatic and tangible articulation of Orthodox spirituality to both young people and spiritual seekers. Father Terrell serves as the priest at St. Mary of Egypt Serbian Orthodox Church in Kansas City, Missouri, where he attends with his wife, Juliana, and their 8 children. The title of his talk is On Earth as It Is in Heaven. Please welcome Father Terrell.
In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, Christ is in our midst. I greet all of you, my beloved ones, at this annual conference of St. Moses. The theme for this year's conference of peace through the blood of the cross, the drawing together of the divided ones, is timely. We have now in 2021 seen unprecedented division in the world and within the church, and not simply localized communities and parishes, but the whole of the church. What are we to make of this? We as Orthodox Christians should expect nothing less from the world. And as we saw in 2020, anything is possible. My brothers and my sisters, we should not be surprised. The Apostle Peter tells us in his first epistle that it is time for judgment to begin with the household of God. And if it begins with us first, what will be the outcome for those who do not obey the gospel of God? Or, as another translation states it, judgment begins with the family of God. Again, what are we who are living in such confusing and perilous times to make of this? Times which are all but devoid of any patristic and divine guidance. We are seemingly lost. Children without a father. However, I believe that it is precisely by looking to not only the fathers of the church, but to the Father Almighty, as our Lord and Savior Jesus taught us to do in prayer, that we will discover not simply a way out of the confusion we have found ourselves in, but rather we will discover His holy guidance and love both in and through these circumstances. We will see, if we wish to, the wisdom and truth that judgment starts with the family of God. And more importantly, that in this wisdom, we will discover the means to true reconciliation, a real gathering of those scattered that is only possible by the Father of Lights. To be clear, I believe this is true for all the Orthodox faithful. Nevertheless, I am addressing those gathered together for the annual St. Moses the Black Conference. And I find this message to be of particular importance and need for our fellowship. One cannot give what one does not already have. And I believe the core work of the fellowship is to further the work of the gospel among those who have not had the opportunity to encounter the fullness of the good news, which is found only within the whole of the holy ark of orthodoxy. Moreover, I find the confusion that disoriented both the world and the church has also seemingly set back the evangelistic efforts to reveal orthodoxy to African Americans, who, as a people, once again find ourselves caught in between larger political narratives, to the detriment of any spiritual progress. In short, the efforts and movements of the world continue to be at odds with the desires and hopes of heaven, and the longer we persist in not discerning the difference between the machinations of the world and the work of the other world, which is the heavenly kingdom. I fear this fellowship and all its efforts could find itself not simply fading away, but God forbid, being used to sow further seeds of division. With God's help, I will be using the Our Father an accompanying patristic commentary to help discern the truth that the missing component for any form of reconciliation is actually repentance. So let us begin. Our Father, who art in the heavens, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. In the Gospel of Luke, we read, one day Jesus was praying in a certain place, and when he finished, one of his disciples said to him, Lord, teach us to pray, just as John taught his disciples. With this very question and request, the apostles seek to hear from Jesus on how to pray. I first would point out that the apostles are asking according to their best understanding, according to the example that they had seen in what St. John the forerunner had shown them. And it's precisely here that the heart of what the Lord's Prayer has for this fellowship is revealed, because it is in the revelation of the Father Almighty and his absolute holiness, his complete otherness, that we can begin to see that he is the only source of life and unity. Our Father, who art in heavens, hallowed be thy name. This point is so foundational that when you read further in St. Luke's account of the Lord's Prayer, our King continues in this teaching on the absolute need for unity, whether it is the unity and relation between friends in need, an earthly father and his son, and even the reality of folly of division within the kingdom of the divider, the devil himself. It's clear from his proclamation of the Father Almighty as the source and foundation of relation and identity that unity is in of itself powerful. What is the source of the true relation identity, and what makes it true? This source is found in the ability to call the Great and Holy One, who is without beginning and who made all things both visible and invisible, Father, that we can call him who is above and outside of everything, Father. This unfathomable privilege is revealed in the Lord's Prayer, and it is precisely in the eternal nature by which this relation is given to us that we see its truth. Because it's a relation that is not contingent on temporal and death-laden categories such as nation and class. It is an eternal identity because he is eternal. Nevertheless, let us look to the Father for greater understanding and an even more particular insight. St. Maximus the Confessor, in his commentary in the Lord's Prayer, states, the Logos bestows adoption on us when he grants us that birth and deification, which, transcending nature, comes by grace from above through the Spirit. The guarding and preservation of this in God depends on the resolve of those thus born, on their sincere acceptance of the grace bestowed on them, and through the practice of the commandments, on their cultivation of the beauty given to them by grace. Moreover, by emptying themselves of the passions, they lay hold of the divine to the same degree that to which, deliberately emptying himself of his own sublime glory, the Logos of God truly became man. We see here, according to St. Maximus, that this identity is one of adoption and contingent on our participation, that if we wish to be sons and daughters of the King, then we must strive to honor this gift or birthright. And lest anyone would have their pride or the devils deceive them in regard to this contingency, St. Maximus is clear that it is only with the needed humility of accepting this gift that the actual ability to pursue and practice the commandments is made possible. This is the gospel, that Christ has made a way, that we who are dead in sin may come alive, and that we are called to be so much more than beggars receiving a handout. Rather, we are called to become free children of the Most High, freed from the bondage of slavery to sinful passions and ignorant whims. St. Maximus goes further, expounding on the profound gift and calling found in the Lord's Prayer. He writes, the Logos has made men equal to the angels. Not only did he make peace through the blood of his cross between things on earth and things in heaven, and reduce to impotence the hostile powers that fill in the mediary region between heaven and earth, thereby making the festal assembly of earthly and heavenly powers a single gathering for his distribution of divine gifts, with humankind joining joyfully with the powers on high in unanimous praise of God's glory, but also after fulfilling the divine purpose undertaken on our behalf, when he was taken up with the holy body which he had assumed, he united heaven and earth in himself, joined what is sensible with what is intelligible, and revealed creation as a single whole, whose extremes are bound together through virtue and through knowledge of their first cause. He shows, I think, through what he has accomplished mystically, that the Logos unites what is separated, and that alienation from the Logos divides what is united. Let us learn, then, to strive after the Logos through the practice of the virtues. so that we may be united not only with the angels through virtue, but also with God in spiritual knowledge through the detachment from created things. How can we, my brothers and my sisters, as Orthodox Christians who are inheritors of such patristic and philokalic wisdom, not see that the false and corrosive unity of perishable categories is fundamentally at odds with our high calling, which is in fact the lost message of the gospel, that God has a high calling for those who would be his children? And yet I ask you, my brothers and my sisters, is the work, or at least the perception of what the work should be of the fellowship of St. Moses, lining up with his high and mighty call? Or is our work mimicking and groping after the vain and toxic ways of the world? Do we really think that the world knows what is best for African Americans? Do we really think that the broken and skewed narratives of resentment and victimhood are true and eternal? Do we not see that in fact it is those who are of the world who would seek to establish themselves as the great benefactors and saviors of people of color, who are actually the ones who do all they can to obscure and deny this high calling, this gospel? How can we call anyone to unity if we are not calling them to true unity, which is found only in the bosom of the Almighty Father? How can we call anyone to the prize of adoption if we ourselves do not know what the Heavenly One both asks and desires to bestow upon those who seek? Remember that our Lord states clearly after he gave the teaching of this prayer that we are to ask and it will be given, seek and you will find. And so thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Again, I refer to the previous words of St. Maximus when he says, he united heaven and earth and himself, joined what is sensible and what is intelligible, and revealed creation as a single whole, whose extremes are bound together through virtue and through knowledge of their first cause. Here on the east side of Kansas City, our community of St. Mary of Egypt has invested much into building a beautiful temple in the middle of a neighborhood that most wouldn't even want to drive through. For us, it's simply a matter of understanding what enlightens and transforms the mind and hearts of people made in God's image. It's beauty, a true beauty which will save the world, true beauty which is in fact revelation. I've come to understand it's not poverty and blight of buildings that slowly suffocates a community. It's in fact ignorance. Ignorance that suffocates, an ignorance of the fact that a community is more than its physicality. Furthermore, that poverty and blight too often define the souls that live there. It is the ignorance of the kingdom that is to come and is actually accessible now, even in the midst of blight and poverty. We human beings are now that bridge between the visible and the invisible worlds. This includes especially the souls that find themselves inhabiting spaces that are defined by trauma and poverty. I see clearly that the great tragedy isn't that there are souls that suffer from poverty, rather, that these souls aren't being encouraged and equipped to embrace their God-given calling of transforming those very spaces of poverty and trauma into paradise. You may find this far-fetched, and I would say to you, I would submit to you, that this is precisely the problem. If we are to draw the divided, then we must first see the things that hinder the vision of the divided, the things that divide and distort the vision of the Father who created them to be like him, who created us to be holy temples in which his Holy Spirit would dwell, who created us to be bridges and conduits by which the whole of creation would be united and made holy. I find that this is also the key, that we must learn to dispel in truth and love any false doctrines and sects which seek to marry the souls and minds of African Americans to demonic ideas and practices which only seek to destroy the ability to see the Father, or those worldly and equally demonic political movements which seek to chain African Americans down to the dying earth through the inflammation of the passions and resentment. I submit to all of you that in reality this has been one of the ways in which we are not drawing the divided ones, one of the ways we are not doing the needed work. We need to put our efforts in uncovering the calling of the Lord and not looking to the world which in reality is doing the covering. We need to not simply call people to unite. We need to show them that the path of purification, illumination, and deification as found in the Holy Church is actually the means to uniting heaven and earth. We must discourage the disastrous rallying around fallen and sinful men and call the world to rally around the God-man, Jesus Christ. And so now we come to give us this day our daily bread and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Upon first glance at this portion of the Lord's Prayer, it is tempting to allow our thoughts to quickly run to an exclusively materialist interpretation and connection with the asking of daily bread. I don't think this is completely unfair. However, it's a common conclusion of association that of its own has in fact done nothing to further the deeper and more needed work. If we are able to understand the calling of man to be a bridge between the earthly and heavenly, the material and immaterial facets of reality as seen in our relation to the Father, then a purely materialistic interpretation and approach isn't enough to reveal this high calling. Again, St. Maximus. I believe that the expression "this day" refers to the present age. It is as if one should say, after a clear understanding of the context of the prayer, "Since we are in the present mortal life, give us this day our daily bread, which thou hast originally prepared for human nature, so that it might become immortal. For in this way, the food of the bread of life and knowledge will triumph over the death that comes through sin." He who prays to receive this daily bread, however, does not automatically receive it at all, as if it is in itself. He receives it in accordance with his receptive capacity. For the bread of life in his love gives himself to all who ask, but he does not give to all in the same way. He gives liberally to those who have done great things, and more sparingly to those who have achieved less. Thus he gives to each person in accordance with his receptive capacity of his or her intellect. If, however, we also take this clause to mean we should pray for the daily bread that sustains our present life, let us be careful not to overstep the bounds of the prayer, presumptuously, assuming that we will live for many cycles of years and forgetting that we are mortal and that our life passes by like a shadow. But free from anxiety, let us pray for bread sufficient for one day at a time, thus showing that as Christian philosophers, we make life a rehearsal of death. In our purpose, anticipating nature, and even before death comes, cutting off the soul's anxiety about bodily things. In this way, the soul will not transfer its natural appetite to material things, attaching itself to what is corruptible, and will not learn the greed that deprives it of a rich possession of divine blessings. The preoccupation and false equivocation of poverty with blackness has done nothing but reinforce all the death-dealing stereotypes of false saviors. We, as the Fellowship of St. Moses, and those who would be associates of the Fellowship, need to reject any worldly narrative that reinforces such destructive tendencies. And more importantly, we need to understand and preach the otherworldly virtues that actually connect African Americans to Holy Orthodoxy: suffering and forgiveness. Suffering, or rather the willingness to suffer, is so essential to true Christianity that this whole conference and any other subsequent conference could easily be dedicated to it. It is by no means an exaggeration to say this. However, I will provide this word by a holy sufferer, a passion bearer of Romania, whose suffering both as an individual and as a representative of his people is beyond the comprehension of most Americans. Valeriu Gathenko, while at Aiud prison, said, "Suffering, no matter how difficult it may be, has no other meaning than the cleansing of souls thirsting for salvation." For me, this is the most succinct statement on the Orthodox understanding of human suffering, and is precisely what this world is seeking to rob African Americans of, which in truth is the real means to the true and eternal identity and inheritance of the Father. So much of the Fellowship's early work was grounded in showing and building off of that understanding and connection of suffering with the slave roots and suffering experience of African Americans and Holy Orthodoxy. That was the noble work that actually united and inspired. That is the work that revealed the shared experience of Greeks, Arabs, Russians, Serbians, and African Americans. And I believe it's something that we desperately need to return to. Because it's in that awareness that the most powerful work and Christian virtue is apprehended: forgiveness. Again, a profound and succinct statement of Orthodox spirituality, this time by our Holy Father, St. Silouan the Athenite. "Whoever will not love his enemies cannot know the Lord and the sweetness of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit teaches us to love our enemies in such a way that we pity their souls as if they were our own children." Is this not the way? So clear, yet so counterintuitive to any worldly understanding, thus revealing its divine origins. This is what we need to put our whole efforts into: teaching, preaching, living this otherworldly faith, Holy Orthodoxy. My brothers and my sisters, if we return to these sublime truths, this would become the repentance that could again inspire both the faithful and the world with the heavenly call, and it would bring about the final and most important aspect of the Lord's Prayer in regard to what is needed in order to unite the divided. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. Again, St. Maximus. Scripture reveals in these words that he who has not completely forgiven those who stumble and has not brought his heart to God free from grievance and illuminated with the light of reconciliation with his neighbor will fail to attain the grace of the blessings he has prayed for. Indeed, he will justly be handed over to temptation and to evil, so that having retracted his judgments of other people, he may learn to purify himself of his own sins. Scripture here means by temptation the law of sin, of which the first man was free when he was created, and by what is evil, it means the devil, who has mixed this law of sin with human nature, deceitfully persuading man to transfer his soul's desire from what is permitted to what is forbidden, and to turn aside to the transgressions of the divine commandment. So long as he prays merely in words for liberation, God allows him to be defiled by the law of sin. And so long as his will is stubborn and raw, God abandons him to the dominion of evil. For he has chosen the shameful passions of which the devil is the sower, in preference to nature of which God is the creator. God leaves man free to incline, if man so wishes, towards the passions of the flesh, and actually to satisfy that inclination, valuing the insubstantial passions more highly than nature. In his concern for these passions, he has become ignorant of the principles of nature. Is this not what has happened? Does this not describe what the fruit of all the worldly and demonic political and socioeconomic philosophies have falsely put forth as the reasons and solutions to the divisions in the world? Is this really always the material aspects of race and poverty? Is this why people are fundamentally at odds and divided? No. The fathers tell us it's actually our lack of repentance from our sins. And that lack of repentance simply feeds the ability and work of the devil. But many might even now say, that is too simple of a solution, that it sounds unsophisticated and crude. I grant that it is simple, but perhaps it's the very absence of simplicity that has continued to foment confusion, frustration, and resentment, when instead there should be clarity, hope, and healing. It seems to me that when we see how quickly and fiercely divisions and confusions have come upon the family of God, there's no need to seek more complex reasons. In fact, it's in that seeking of complexity that the culprit is revealed. Most have heard the quote that the greatest trick the devil ever pulled was convincing the world he didn't exist. Well, it's true. But let me tell you a phrase that we use here in Kansas City. If someone shows you who they are, believe them. We've seen the fruit of the world's approach to unity and justice. It has brought nothing but greater destruction and served as cover to even greater evils of confusion and identitarian idolatry. Another quote, not as well known, but just as good, is this. The second greatest trick the devil ever pulled was convincing the world he is the good guy. This has been the story of the last few years. It's time we wipe the sleep from our eyes and wake up to the wiles of the devil. Having said all this, it can seem like I'm painting a bleak picture full of finger-pointing and self-righteousness. But my brothers and my sisters, I couldn't be further from the truth of my intentions, because I have my eyes set on something so beautiful, so divine, that the only way to bring this final point was to make as clear as possible the folly and darkness that has been so seductive. This final point, this divine clarion call that needs to be sounded, is repentance. This is what is needed. This is how we unite the divided. This is how we solve race issues. This is how we redeem the efforts of not just the Fellowship of St. Moses, but the whole church here and now in this new age. We must seek repentance for us first, because judgment has come for us first. And then, and only then, will we see the fruit of that being given to others. Then we will be able to truly pray, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one.